Okay, bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa ashabi jma'in wa ba'd. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to our second class on the principles of the Creed of Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah, book 2 of Imam al-Ghazali's Ihya Ulum al-Din. We have some refreshments out for you, so please do grab a cup of tea, something, quick bite if you want, biscuits, etc. There's no harm in doing so, inshallah ta'ala. You don't need to look at that, ignore that, I can't take it down, so just going to leave it there just for you to look at, but ignore it at the same time. So last week we did a bit of an introduction into the topic of Aqidah and kind of why we're here and why we're learning. And then we started reading the text itself. We're going to follow the text in Arabic and English. So for those of you who haven't got the book, it is available. I think we've got one or two copies left, inshallah ta'ala. So we reached a section here where, actually we're on the page 4, right? So we just quickly go back and just read the English of what Imam Ghazali said, and I want to make maybe a couple more points before we move on to today's topic, inshallah. So Imam Ghazali starts off by saying, you know, Tawfiq is from Allah, success is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Praise be to Allah, the beginner, the restorer. He who does what he wills, fa'alu lima yurid, possess of the glorious throne and intense force. He who guides his pure servants to the right way and the firm path. He who blesses them after their attestation to his unity by guarding their creed from the darkness of doubt and uncertainty. He who steers them toward the immolation of his messenger, the chosen prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It'll go off in a minute. And aids and strengthens them in following the tracks to his noble, honored companions. May Allah please with them. He who manifests himself, this is the part I wanted to reach, to them in his essence and acts through the beautiful qualities of his attributes, which can only be perceived by he who listens while he is present in mind. So Imam Ghazali is telling you something, that what I'm going to mention afterwards is not what I think. This is not an opinion of Imam Ghazali. This is what Allah tells us. He has manifested himself. He has shown himself. He has revealed things about himself, revelation of the Quran and the sayings of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And that's what we need to take. So I wanted to take a little step back here at this point before we go on and ask a few questions. First of all, what's your favorite dish? I was asking a few people, we know, what's the craze today? Somebody's telling me this Echi Mehmet steakhouse now in town. You know, somebody eyes opened up there. But they cut the, you know, steak in front of you and all that kind of thing. If has he been there? You haven't yet? Okay, we need to go down, inshallah. So I was asking, like, what's the biggest dessert? Freak shakes, somebody said, that's quite in now or something, right? What am I asking this for? Let me take a step back. What is happiness? Right? Are you happy because you've got money? Yeah, I'm happy because I've got money. Okay, why? Because it allows me to get things, belongings, house, car, clothes. Okay, so you're happy because you've got clothes? You're happy because you've got a mobile phone? You're happy because you've got a car? Right? Is that it then? Full stop? That's what makes us happy and that's it? No, actually, I'm happy because I've got people around me. I've got family, right? I've got a community. I've got people who love me. That's what makes me happy, right? So maybe that's a bit, you know, a better way of thinking. But there's something actually we're missing. Because if we are happy because of all of these things, what happens when we lose them? We'll become sad. And trust me, when you lose money, what happens? When you lose a £10 note, Ramadan, what happens? Very happy. You're like, where's my £10 gone? It's like you've had a heart attack or something, right? Like, if you missed a few heartbeats there, where's my... The best one's the phone. When you don't know where your phone is, how do you feel, right? Heart attack, panic attack. I was reading this, like 60, 70% people have panic attacks if they don't know where their phone is. Because when we lose the source of our happiness, what does it turn into? A very dark place, really. It's not a nice place to go. So I was reading something, I want to share it with you as well. Imagine if right now you went to sleep, right? So close your eyes, we'll do exercise. Close your eyes. Shaban, said close your eyes, please. And somebody said, we're going to, you know, transport you somehow miraculously to a cruise ship. So now imagine like you're on a cruise ship, yeah? Your holiday of a lifetime, yep. And then don't open your eyes. And now you're on this cruise ship and you're getting all the best food, like we mentioned, and all games and enjoyment. And, you know, everything's hosted for you, looked after, catered, waiters, whatever, right? And, you know, you're just on this ship in the middle of nowhere sailing, right? Would you be happy? Yes, no? Enjoying yourself? Yes, no? But would you truly be happy? After a while, what would happen? You just start asking questions. Where is this ship going? How did I get here? You just told me to close my eyes and imagine, but how did I get here? You know? Who sent me? What's going on? You know, you just start asking more questions. But somebody comes along and says, forget about those questions. Here, have this, you know, ice cream. You know, have some, have this milkshake. Have a cafe latte or something, right? Have these, you know, have these crispy cremes. And distracts you from those questions, yeah? So now you think, okay, forget that. I'll enjoy myself again. So you're, you know, in enjoyment again. And every time you start thinking of, okay, where are we going? What's the purpose of this journey? I can't just, you know, eat and drink all the night and all the day and everything. There's got to be more to it. So then you open your eyes and you see, you don't see the sea, you don't see a ship, you see a hole in the ground. Open your eyes. And the hole in the ground is your grave. And you're being lowered into your grave. You missed the opportunity. That ship you were sailing on was your life. And those questions you were asking were genuine questions that we all ask. Why am I here? What's the purpose of life? It's probably the question, isn't it? Why am I here? And what were people doing around you? They were distracting you with what you see around you right now. Those things we mentioned, food, drink, clothes, cars, everything. They weren't allowing you to figure out what you're here for, to answer that question. And the answer to that question wasn't out there. It was in here. The answer is not to be found. You see things, but the answer ultimately comes from within. But you're distracted from yourself because of the world, because of people, because of the dunya, as we call it, the worldly things around us. And therefore, that prevents us from achieving something which is the goal of our lives, really, which is happiness, yes, but not just the temporal, worldly happiness, but, you know, real happiness, true happiness. Right, meaningful happiness, that one that will last forever, yes. The one that will never result in sadness or anything after it. And that is to be found with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? It's to be found with the one that put us on this journey. That's the question, isn't it? Who put us here, right? If you don't believe, it's a pretty dim world, right? Well, why am I here? What's going on? Nobody sent me here. It's a bit random. And that's what people believe. They believe everything's random. You know, people who are atheists, they think it was all by chance, haphazard. You know, survival of the fittest, and this is how we got to where we are today. But that in itself, I personally believe, is quite illogical, because you don't get order from disorder. You don't get, we've all got reasoning, let's take ourselves, like I said, the answer's in ourselves. We've all got rationale, intellect, reasoning. That can't come from, we've got a rule, which I think everybody agrees to as a rational kind of logical rule. If you don't have something, and I think I mentioned this in some of our classes before, if you don't have something, you can't give it to somebody else. So I've got no money, can't give you any money, I'm sorry, right? I haven't got no skills like, you know, how to paint, I can't teach you how to paint. Or to extend the rule, you haven't got the ability, you haven't got that thing, or you haven't got the ability to pass on that thing, or to acquire it and pass it on. So yes, I can give you money by earning it and passing it on to you, but if I don't have the ability of, you know, if I don't possess money, or I don't have the ability of earning money, then can I ever give you that? Okay, so let's go back to this point. We have reason. Where did reason come from? Who gave us reason? If you believe nothing, if you believe haphazard, you know, atoms and molecules start coming together, they had no intellect, reason, thought, the whole belief, you know, this naturalism or whatever they call it, right? It comes from this whole idea that there was no rationale, there was nothing. So how can that have, itself doesn't have any reasoning rationale, itself doesn't have any ability to give you or attain it and give it to you. So the whole idea of saying there's nothing out there destroys the whole, it's a fallacy, you know, it's just a ridiculous, illogical point to make. What we believe is there is intelligent, if that's the right word, you know, knowing, wise, all-seeing, all-hearing, being, reality, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out there, that can give that to us, that does have the potential to create that within us. You see, that to me makes more sense. That to me is a more of a logical approach. I still have to believe that, I still have to take the leap of faith. I'm not saying it's like, you know, 1 plus 1 equals 2, you've got to accept it. It's close to that, I think, and that's why, you know, in the past, and the past doesn't mean a bad time, there wasn't really an argument against God. There wasn't much atheism and attacks on, you know, there was more problem with, you know, how many gods are there? Is there one? Is there multiple? Is there, who is God? The question was. Recently, in the last sort of century or two, there has been a movement against belief in God and atheism and so forth. You know, it was brought into the idea of parliament and, you know, etc. because this country and other countries were based on belief. If you look at the Quran takes the default position that God exists and there's no argument needed for the existence of God. The argument that Allah presents is why there should be one God. Tawheed, wahdaniya, right? The fact that God exists isn't something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to us, you know what, there's got to be a lot of proofs and discussions and this and that. No, why should we believe in one God? What are the attributes of the creator? There's a creator, there's somebody, something out there, creation, creator, intelligent being, powerful, all-knowing. Okay, what is it that we can learn and understand? There are actually things we can learn and understand by just thinking about it, you know, logically deducing things. But in reality, we won't know everything, we won't know the full picture, unless we are given revelation. Unless the one out there, I say out there, the one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, tells us. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us within the revelation. So not just Islam, but all the previous prophets, all the previous books, messengers, etc. They all brought revelation, which is communication from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the creation via a messenger or prophet, right? That's how Allah works, that's how Allah decided to make the whole system, and we believe in them and they have validity. Why should we, okay, now the question arises, why should we believe in the prophets, which I mentioned last week as well, and then that we have to answer, and then we answer that, okay, we believe in them, so now they have revelation and they are telling us things, so we have to believe in the whole package, what they tell us about Allah Almighty, and we learn about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now we understand who sent us here, who that creator is, what he is all about. And in that message, it clearly tells us why we are here as well. And that is that we're going back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the destination, the ship, where is it leading to? Yeah, there's a grave, but actually there's something going to happen in that grave and beyond, which Allah tells us about. So the journey doesn't stop at the grave for us, right? It may well do in the beliefs of some people, but in the beliefs of those who believe in an afterlife, that's the first stage of the next life. It's a journey that continues, which Allah talks about in the Quran, and Prophet mentions in the Hadith, etc. And ultimately, we have to stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and be held accountable. So accountability is something that we have in our lives as Muslims, as believers. That's part of the journey. If you ignore that, if you want to be in that ship and just enjoy yourself, you don't have any fear of an accountability if you think about it. As long as I can, and I remember that school, you know, when you're at school, you've been last year, year 11, you know, we're all leaving school and we're all talking about things, and, you know, you go through changes at university, at college, every different, but this was at school. One of the students, he was a Christian, and he, I don't know if he's a devout Christian, but he believed in Christianity and so forth. So he was talking about, you know, et cetera, et cetera. And there was a third person, you know, from myself and him, and what we were talking about was that, what do you want to do in life? Where do you want to go? What do you believe? You know, what's it all about, kind of thing. And that third person didn't believe in an afterlife, didn't believe in the kind of purpose in life. So he said, the purpose of life is just to enjoy yourself as much as possible, and who cares what happens after that? The purpose of life is to enjoy yourself. This is a 16-year-old young man who says, the purpose of life is to enjoy yourself as much as possible, and who cares what happens after that? Right, who cares what you do in life then? Yeah, who cares what Hitler did? Who cares about what Stalin did? Who cares about all the massacres and things that are going on right now, it doesn't matter to us because we don't care. We're enjoying ourselves, and we can, you know, get drunk and be zombies and then just wake up in the morning and, you know, go back to work. Because that's the life you probably went on to live, I don't know, right? But that is a very sad life. You know, it's not a very purposeful, meaningful life that's going to have true happiness. Yes, that enjoyment is going to be that distraction, constant distraction of you think you're happy, but then you actually realize, no, that's not happiness, and you try and find it somewhere else. So people will move, and, you know, it does happen that you move from one thing to another to find happiness. And it's not a nice, you know, cycle to be in, because it doesn't get pleasurable. It actually starts to hurt at one point. You think you find pleasure in, you know, social media, and then you think, no, let's watch YouTube. Then you think, no, let's go and get involved in this project, and let's go involved in, you know, traveling. Let's, and the end of all of it, there's no purpose, true meaning and purpose, until you bring in that there is an external factor to this. It's not us. We didn't bring ourselves here. We didn't just, you know, randomly appear on this cruise ship. There's a purpose behind it all. And once we look at that, we realize we need help. And God Almighty, the Creator, has helped us. And if we want to reject that, fine. There's an accountability and there'll be repercussions. But if we accept that, then we will hopefully make it and be successful. And in this, I mentioned this before as well, Imam Ghazali has a book actually on in a similar wavelength, and he called this book Kimiyatus Sa'ada. Kimia is the old age word for alchemy, which is now used for chemistry, which was turning, you know, metals into gold. But the real happiness that Imam Ghazali wanted to teach us about was salvation on the Day of Judgment, was knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he wrote another book similar to these, you know, his book, other books, about, and he was written in Persian, so it was actually a book written in the Persian language. Later translated into Arabic and then English, so it's available in English as well, called The Alchemy of Happiness, in which he tells us the road to happiness. He tells us how to achieve this meaningful, true, real happiness that we all search for. We all, you know, that's what we're after. That's what Allah has made within us. But we will only find that with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And everyone talked about, all the scholars talked about this. It's in the books. It's maybe not something we always talk about, but it is mentioned. There's a saying of Imam Ibn Ata'illah As-Sakandari, a scholar from Egypt, where he kind of alludes to this. He doesn't say it literally like, you know, happiness is this. But what he says is, if you want real status, is honor, respect. If you want real respect and, I'd say, substance, you know, and meaning in your life, then don't seek it from something. Don't seek this respect, meaning, you know, إِذَا أَرَدْتَ أَنْ يَكُونَ عِزٌ لَا يَفْنَى. If you want عِز that does not ever perish, فَلَا تَسْتَعِزَنَّ بِعِزٍ يَفْنَى. Then don't seek it from things that die out. When you seek it from the world, it all dies out. What are you left with? No happiness, no meaningfulness, no respect. Where do you have to seek it for then? He doesn't say it, but he means seek it from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you seek your happiness through Allah, so for that reason your family is a source of happiness, when you realize my family is a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's nothing wrong with being happy with everything you're given in life. We're not here saying throw the world away and sit somewhere and ignore everything, no. But if you don't make Allah the source of your happiness, then yes, that is a distraction from Allah, isn't it? That phone you've got, that money you've got, the house you've got. It's not, I thank Allah that He's provided me with this. I'm thanking Allah that He's given me these blessings. I'm happy for the sake that Allah is with me for, you know. It's not that. It's, I'm happy because I've got a house. Ha ha ha, right? My life's great. Everybody else's life is boring because I've got a better house than them. A bigger house than them. Well, yeah, that king's got a bigger house than you and that king's got a bigger house than him. There's always somebody above somebody else, unless you're the wealthiest man or woman in the world, right? But, you know, and we're not. None of us here are, alhamdulillah, right? We've been given a normal, and to be honest, it's a protection. If you're not given wealth, it's not a blemish or a bad thing. Allah protects us by giving us what we need on this journey, right? Nobody's going to be denied of what they need and what they require on this journey to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So everything can be good if we, you know, to put it simply, put Allah into the equation. If, as soon as we take Allah out and we ignore, we heedless as well, then it becomes a pretty sad life, pretty, you know, if we really reflect on it, it becomes, you know, meaningless. It becomes empty. You know, there's that emptiness we'll feel ultimately. After all those distractions are gone, it will be empty. Because all those enjoyments and things are illusions, fantasies, distractions. Once they dissipate and they die out, that's why, you know, people want a bigger hit, don't they? They want to get more enjoyment from something else. They want to try something more crazy. You know, when you think about it, why do people climb Everest for? Why do they jump off mountains? And because they want more enjoyment. They've done everything else. These people are on that journey of just enjoyment, enjoyment, enjoyment. So they've got a life, but they don't care about life. They want to enjoy themselves. So if they end up falling off a mountain and dying, which they do, by the way, that's the risk they took because they were after what? Enjoyment. After enjoyment, people die. Yes, they do. Because they think that is the only way to live life. That is their, you know, some people find enjoyment in just, you know, sitting at home doing Sudoku. Alhamdulillah, I like that as well. But some people like jump off mountains. Some people like jump off airplanes, right? It's different, right? Be like me, just stick to Sudoku. It's good for your brain as well, right? Word searches and whatnot. So now we'll move on to this. Because this is now what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. Allah says in the next page now, He discloses and informs them, i.e. revelation. So Imam Ghazali is saying, Al-Mu'arrifu Iyahum, He has made Himself known to them, i.e. to the Sahaba, to the Prophets, to us, because we're part of that same whole concept of humans placed on the earth that need guidance and revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Creator. And what has He made known to them? He's made known to them that He is one in His essence, without partner. Not that He exists. He's made known to them that Allah, their Creator, which we accept, is one, without partner, unique, without likeness, absolute, without opposite, singular, without rival. So that's a whole kind of passage we need to explain before we move on to the next point. So first of all, He is wahidun. That's the word used in Arabic. La sharika lahu. And I'm sure we know these words. Wahidun la sharika lahu. He's one without a partner, without a co-equal. Fardun la mathila lahu. He is unique without anyone who's similar. It says here, without likeness. Samadun. Allahu samad. He is samadun. Eternal. La didda lahu. Without a predecessor. There's no did or somebody you can rival, maybe. One word you could use here. Rival is used after that, actually, so we'll leave that. Munfaridun la nidda lahu. He is munfarid, alone. It's a singular. He's no one is like him. He's alone in his attributes, in his description, in his reality. La nidda lahu. There is no rival, somebody who has any equivalent attributes or anything that could be described as divine. So this is the first thing that we need to understand. There is a complete contrast between the Creator and the creation. Nothing of the creation resembles the Creator, and none of the divine realities, attributes represent or resembling the creation. There's a complete contrast. Contradiction is the word we use in English, right? In Arabic, it's munaqada, right? Which is different to opposite. Allah's not opposite. Allah's contradictory. You know, we're in a contradiction, meaning they can't exist together. They can't be compared, because things on a like black and white are on a spectrum of colors. They're opposites. You got black, you got white, and then you got red and yellow and orange in the middle, green and blue, etc. So Allah's not like an end of a spectrum where there's a comparison to Him. He's just not on that spectrum whatsoever. He's a contradiction to everything we know, if you can say that. This is the terminology they'd use to be, you know, correct 100%. So this is what the first point that Imam al-Ghazali is making. The one that created us is not like us. Okay, this is a mistake. And again, if we could all go back to the idea of, you know, people who don't believe, one of the arguments they use for we don't believe, and I've discussed this before, but we'll mention it again, because, you know, some of you haven't been here for the previous classes, is that why is there suffering? Why is there evil? If there was a God, there was a true God, in their opinion, would He not have removed all of that? Would He not have had just a, you know, perfect world, no suffering, no cancer, no diseases for children, no murders, you know, all this kind of thing we see right now, out there in the world, so much is going on, right? So how can we believe in God? We don't believe in God. Can't believe in God. So really what the argument is saying that I want my God, I want my God to be only able to create perfection, and He's not allowed to create anything else, and then I'll believe in Him. Because what they're saying is only perfection in the world, we'd believe in God. Because no perfection in the world, that's why we should deny God. Right? That's their argument, which is not a correct or valid argument. Because we don't decide what goes on in this world. We do decide what we do, but in reality, we didn't decide to come here in the first place. How many of us decided, you know, who our parents are, right? What ethnicity we were born into, right, where the place we were born, right? We don't have a control over a lot of things prior to our existence, especially, and even during our existence, we don't have control over a lot of things. What's been put out for us here is what the one who created it, if we say God for the time being, decided. Now, the question is what he decided right or wrong? That's what you're trying to say. You're saying it's wrong, so I can't believe in a wrong God. That's the argument. It's evil, so I can't believe in a God that would create evil. That's the exact argument. What do we say? We believe in a God that create evil? Yes, we do say that. We believe in God that can do all this? Yes, we actually do believe in that, because we believe in a God and we believe he does everything. So now are we bad people because we believe in a God that does all these things or allows them to happen, as we say? No, because there has to be a contrast. How do you know what's good if you don't know what bad is? How do you know what black is if you've never seen white? Right? How do you know what tall is if you've never seen anything short? Right? There has to be contrast in this life. Allah decided to put us, and one of the key components of this is give us choice. So if you didn't want a choice and you want Allah to just make you good, that's fine. Allah would have done that. And he has done that, to be honest. He's called created paradise, and he's created the angels as well. They don't do anything bad. But he didn't want to do that. He wanted you to decide. So what he's done is he's given you the potential to do good and the potential to do bad. He's created that. And he's looking at every one of us, seeing what we're going to do. This is our explanation. So within our choices, we choose to do good or we choose to do bad. And God knows that. Yes. It's not that we can't say, oh, God doesn't know what we're going to do. He knows that as well. And he's fully aware of our choices, subhanahu wa ta'ala. But he's given us the ability to choose. He's given us this world and the way it's set up to make the right decisions. Right now, you could lie to your bank and not pay back the £10 they paid you extra. Or you could tell the truth. It's up to you. Right now, you could lie to your neighbor that you bumped their car, or you didn't bump their car, or you did. It's up to you. We say that's your choice. Yep. We say this is human. But we also say there's accountability afterwards. You're not going to get away with the evil. It's got to be done because we've got to live a life of choice. We're not angels and we're not in paradise. We're in the world. It's not a utopian world, as they say. Right? It's not this perfect mirage that we can believe in, or conjure up in our minds, an illusion. It's not. It's a reality that exists. And it's a beautiful reality, to be honest, because this is what allows us to be who we are. This is what allows you, the ones that deny God, to be who you are. Had we not had this setup of good and bad, choosing between things, you wouldn't have been able to be who you are. The intellectual capacity we have is a part of the package. That's why humans can be greater than angels, because they choose, they have intellect and rationale, which allows them to then make the right decisions. The angels are built that way. It's intrinsic within them. They just obey. They just answer to God, and that's it. They don't have anything else. They don't have that ability like humans do. We have been given this amazing ability, right? So this is what we've got to understand, that it's not a utopian world, and it's not a world where we are enforced or forced to pick the right way. No, we have to live a life of choices. That's what Allah has designed for us. And within that, there's going to be people who choose bad things. They think they can get away with them, but no, our belief system, and this, like I said, to me, it makes perfect sense, also tells us the ones that choose bad will have an accountability for it. If not in this life, in the next life. It could be in this life, which is better for us and those who do wrong and get it over and done with in this life. Or you have to pay some form of accountability in the next life, right? So this is very, very important that we don't fall into this trap of, these arguments that people want to make on the basis of the point we started from, of God has to be like this, or God has to do this, then I'll believe in him. We don't define God. God revealed himself to us, the point here. We can't bring God down to human emotions. I feel like, I would forgive this person the hellfire. If God can't forgive, he's not merciful, he's not God. God is not defined by human mercy or the human form of what we consider in our lives to be merciful. We can't impose that on God. We can impose reason, but not human emotion, okay? Like we can't say, I feel this way, God should feel this way. What I mean, it's actually called in fallacies and it's called making analogy of the unseen on the seen. You haven't seen that, you don't know that, but you'd think, oh, it's got to be like this, hasn't it then? I haven't seen that yet. I've not met it yet. I've not experienced it yet. But I'm making an analogy on what I have seen. So what have we all seen in our lives? Humans, world, emotions. So what we think God is that nous, is a false analogy. You're taking something that's absent, unseen, and you're bringing it into the seen world, into your world, in the terms you want. We can't do that. We've got to be objective. We've got to think about it, like what is, you know, logically possible, impossible, and go down this route. And that's what Allah does in the Quran, right? That's what Allah teaches in the Quran. That's what Allah has revealed to us. So there are logical arguments, rational arguments within the Quran, but they're not designed to tackle the problem or the argument of does God exist? The more of God is like this. God is merciful. God is all powerful. God is one. God is not like the creation. So don't compare to the creation. God has no beginning. We all have a beginning. These are the things that we see in the Quran. We learn about the Creator within the Quran, Quranic discourse, which is what Imam Ghazali is giving to us. So the point here now is the first point: don't make analogy of Allah upon humans. Don't bring Allah to the human level and say, right, I'm like this, and I think this is good for a human. God should be like this. Don't do that. That's a false analogy. It's a false comparison. In the same sense, there is like a reference here to Surah Al-Ikhlas with the word Samad. Right? We all know Surah Al-Ikhlas, قُلْ وَلَّهُ أَحَدْ Allah Samad, لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُلَدْ وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُونَ أَحَدْ Four ayat, four, as the scholars mention, concepts that Allah has first, you know, presented to us. The first is that, which is Allah is one, there's no one like Him, so don't compare Him to anyone. It's affirmation. Huwa Allahu Ahad, Allahu Samad. There's no anyone, there's no multiplicity in any way, there's no composition to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and all these kind of things that we've kind of mentioned some of here. Then it's Allahu Samad, the second ayah, which means, and which we haven't actually talked about, the eternal. Which means, and we talked about this in Ramadan in one of the webinars we did on Tafsir Surah Ikhlas, we did the Tafsir of the whole Surah. In that As-Samad, and I think we should learn this, I talked about in Taraweeh as well, if you remember Qasim, talked about Surah Ikhlas and the word As-Samad after our Taraweeh Salah, we had some lessons. And we said that As-Samad means the one that everything is in need of. And it, or Him, Allah, is not in need of anything. That is As-Samad. Everything, every atom, every human, every creature is in need of Allah, of As-Samad, for its existence, for its, you know, coming into existence, remaining in existence, being what it is. Yet Allah, As-Samad, is not in need of any of them. So Allah has given us life, created us, and is sustaining us, but not because He needs us. Not because He has a need when He does that for us. No, Allah Samad, eternal, you know, independent, free of need. So this is, you know, one of the meanings mentioned here. And then I suppose لا ضد له منفرد لا ند له, that could be a kind of reference to the fact that Allah says لم يلد ولم يولد, that He's not caused by anyone. So He's the uncaused cause of the universe. When we said He's the beginning, He's the one that started everything off. He is without beginning. He doesn't have a beginning. He, as that's the next point that's going to be mentioned, that which is why I stopped at that point. He's not produced from anything. You know, nobody made God. God is, was, and always will be. There's no time for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what the Prophet said. كَانَ اللَّهُ وَلَمْ يَكُنْ مَعَهُ شَيْءٍ Allah is, and there's nothing with Him. And the scholars add, and He is now as He always was. There's nothing with Allah in His reality, right? He created things as a creation, but His reality is unique. It's not changed. He didn't gain anything from creating. So Allah wasn't, because what happens if you gain something? You change. Okay, before what were you? You were less. So was Allah less before? Then after creation He became more? No. That's deficiency. That's, you know, not divinity anymore. Allah's got a blemish. And what do we say? We say Subhanallah. When we say Subhanallah, that's what we mean. Allah's not got any shortcomings. Allah is not deficient in any way. Allah is transcendent, as is the next section, inshallah ta'ala. We don't believe, we can't believe in a God that's in need or that changes to become better or worse. Because change either is from good to bad or bad to good. Or the same, but it's a change, meaning that there's something different. Where's the change coming from, right? Why is it changing for? He's created. It's temporal, because change also means that that which was there is no longer there because it's changing to something else. So that previous reality is changed into a new reality. It's got that new reality has a beginning. Allah has no change. Allah is not produced. Allah does not come under that whatsoever. Everything created does, and hence why we've got to hold that contrast as we said at the beginning. Allah is not like the creation, does not have this concept of change or goes from one state to another. And the Prophet said this, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this is what we believe. And then, وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ is the last point there. لَا نِدَّ لَهُ There's no rival. There's no one that can compare to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's no one that is similar to him. There's no one that has anything like his attributes whatsoever. Nobody, nothing. Everything is the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there's absolutely no comparison. You know, if there was the biggest contrast in our lives we would ever come across is Allah and the creation. You know? For instance, I'll give you an example, right? You have a huge building and you have a brick. It's a big contrast, right? Yeah, massive. You have the whole universe and you have a speck of sand, let's say, in the dead desert, right? You know, grain of sand. Massive, contrast difference. When it comes to Allah and the creation, it's infinite. It's not even something you can measure. Okay, it's not measurable, it's immeasurable. We can't fathom the difference between Allah and his creation. Right, but that's something we believe in, that وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ So it's very, very important we understand this. So these are very core and essential points that we build our belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon. Then Imam Ghazali says, He is eternal without a predecessor, timeless without beginning, ever being without end, everlasting without termination. Everlasting without termination. So this now refers to this idea of no beginning for Allah, no end for Allah. Everything else is a beginning and will have an end. And if it survives forever, it's by the permission of Allah. So it's not got an independent power to exist forever. It's only going to exist forever if Allah allows it to exist forever. Why am I saying that? Because we will be in paradise and hell forever. Right? That's forever, abada. Right? But that's Allah's creating and maintaining and sustaining that forever. By itself, paradise. By itself, we could not remain in paradise, or people could remain in hellfire forever. It's Allah's upholding that, supporting that. But He Himself, as an independent reality, Allah Almighty, is of Himself without a need for anything else, never had a beginning, never came into existence, never had anything before Him, because there wasn't a before. So you can't even say that He had anything before Him. There was never a before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There was never a prior, predecessor, time, anything. Allah was, and that's it. That's where we start from, Allah. But He hasn't got a start, right? So we have to start after Allah. Actually, that's the best way to say it. We have Allah, and we start after Allah. When He created, when He decided to do something, in His, in His infinite wisdom, decisions, what He wanted to do, and alhamdulillah, the fact that we're here and we are what we are. Like I said, if it's Allah, it's amazing. That's why I said it's amazing. Like, that's why you should be thankful for what we have, because this is Allah's choice. This is Allah's creation. This is Allah's design, right? So within what we see around us is our miracles, our amazing things. And Allah wants us to look at them. And again, this is one of the Quranic discourses or one of the Quranic themes. Allah wants us to reflect over the creation, and that should lead us to the beauty, the majesty, the attributes of the Creator, the reality of the Creator somewhat, right? They're not distractions from Allah, like I said earlier. They can be distractions. The world can be a distraction. But if it takes us to Allah, then it becomes a means of goodness in our lives, right? So we can use this world for good. The famous point said, وَفِي كُلِّ شَيْءٍ لَهُ آيَةٌ And everything, He has a sign, تَدُلُّ عَلَى أَنَّهُ وَاحِدٌ Which indicates that He is one, subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? Famous line of poetry. وَفِي كُلِّ شَيْءٍ لَهُ آيَةٌ تَدُلُّ عَلَى أَنَّهُ وَاحِدٌ Everything has a sign that He is the one. He is the creator, He is the almighty. So there's no prior beginning whatsoever to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If there was, we'd have a problem. Who created Allah? And that's what the Prophet said. Shaitan will come to you so much to put doubts in your mind. Eventually he'll ask you, who created Allah? Where did Allah begin from? So what do we say in that point? Allahu Rabbi la ushriku bihi ahada. Allah is my Lord. I do not associate any partners with Him. Say la ilaha illallah if you don't know that, right? Just remember Allah is, was, and always will be. No time, no place. We say is, was, and will be for us. That's for us. Allah is, was, and will be for us. But Allah Himself, no time. We can't live without time or understand things outside of a time and space dimension. We have to think like that. That's how we are. We're created within this limited way of living. Allah is not limited by our limits. The same thing, contrast. We're limited by physics, and the world. Allah is not limited by that same thing. So you can't apply those rules to Allah. It's a false analogy. So don't do that. So Allah has not got a beginning. Everything's got a beginning. Yeah, Allah's not like the creation. What does Allah say? هُوَ الْأَوَّلُ وَالْآخِرُ وَالظَّاهِرُ وَالْبَاطِنُ وَهُوَ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٌ, which is at the end of that passage. But we'll read on and we'll finish at this point, inshallah. It says, all sustaining. So this is like another point now. So he is without beginning. He is without end. He'll never finish or die or end. Because he's eternal. The fact that he never had a beginning means he always was there. He can never be not there. He's all sustaining without interruption, constant without waning. He is, was, and ever will be endowed with the qualities of majesty. So he doesn't have new attributes. He was perfect with all of his perfection, majesty, grandeur, beauty, and he will remain as such. Nothing changes, like we said. And the interval of time and passing of lifespans will never bring him to an end or to any change, let alone an end. He doesn't wane, doesn't dissipate, doesn't move away. He stays the same as he is, was, and always will be, perfect in his divine attributes. Rather, he is the first and the last, meaning he is the first without anything being there, khalas. He's the last when everything will be gone. He never dies out. The outward and the inward, meaning he shows himself to us, and also he's hidden as well. Sometimes, in a way, he's apparent and subtle, if you like. We can see Allah and the signs of Allah sometimes. Sometimes we have to work harder. We have to see. We have to work deeper. He's the batin. He's the inward, right? He's the subtle. وَهُوَ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٍ, and he is with everything, all knowing. He knows everything that's happening. He knows everything, why it's being created, what its purpose is. Don't think it's purposeless. There's no thing as being without purpose in this life. Everything has a purpose. Everything. Even those who are going to go to the hellfire have a purpose, right? We have to do things in life. I was watching a video the other day, because it said Damascus on it, that's why I watched it. Damascus knife, right? He took some springs, coils, and he put them into a furnace, melted them down, and made a really nice knife out of it, Damascus knife or something. It was called Damascus dagger or something it was called. And I was like, subhanAllah, without putting that metal into the fire, it wouldn't become a beautiful knife, right? So, burning something is painful. It's got to have, for humans especially. But you know what? It can have a good outcome. The knife there has got brilliant use, etc. This is how Allah has designed the world, that you heat something up and then you can manipulate it, metals, right? So if Allah puts people into the hellfire, it's got to have a purpose as well. It's not evil or wrong or anything like that. It's justice. It's got a purpose. So nothing is without purpose in this life, in the next life, or in anything, because it's the creation of Allah. Allah knows everything, every atom and every meaning of everything. And that's how we need to understand. And we need to, inshallah, learn more and more about what Allah has told us about Himself, about the journey, and about the destination. Right? So Himself is what we're doing right now. So that's why Imam Ghazali starts the book off with Allah. You need to know what Allah is. Allah is going to tell us, He's going to tell us within this, that we need to worship Allah. How do we worship Allah? Imam Ghazali will tell you about that. And then at the end of the Ihya al-Umbidi, this book 40, by the way, so it's like, a few years down the line, Allah tells you about the afterlife. Imam Ghazali talks about the afterlife. He talks about, remember that the last book 40 of the Ihya al-Umbidi is Dhikrul Mawti wa Ma Ba'dahu, remembrance of death and what comes after it, of the afterlife, the grave, the day of judgment, all these kind of things. So that's our journey. We're on a journey with Imam Ghazali. We started off by understanding why we need to learn and the importance of learning. Now we're learning about what Allah has revealed about Himself. It's going to be a slow but inshallah important journey. We can speed it up, but I really want to make these points stick in your minds for the rest of your life. Because we studied this, and this was the base of everything for us. The Aqidah, beliefs, are the base for your practice, the base of your Iman, the base of your morals and manners in the future. This is the biggest impact. This is the core. This is the foundation. Usul al-Din is called the foundations of our faith. You have Usul Fiqh, you have Usul Hadith, that's subjects within Islam. You have Usul al-Din, which is the foundations of our faith, of the whole religion. That's this subject. It's called Usul al-Din because it's what sets the purpose. There's no point having, worship. There's no point having an afterlife. We don't believe in the God that created all of that. Right? So we have to believe in Him and understand Him, and then we can move on to worshiping Him and preparing for what He has asked us to prepare for, and the journey and the end and the return, which is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which He talks about, which Allah talks about throughout the Quran, wa ilayhi turja'un, wa ilayhi al-masir, you know, and so forth. To him is your return. To him you is your final outcome. Walillahi aqibatul umur, and to Allah return the ends of all affairs. You know, so many passages in the Quran we talk about the end being with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we have to keep that in mind. That's part of the journey, which is why Imam Ghazali will talk about that, and we'll get onto that, inshallah ta'ala. Any questions for today? Yes, brother.
Sheikh, you mentioned about angels that are in the free world.
Sorry, say that again.
You mentioned about angels that
yep.
are obligated to do good.
Yes.
I'm just trying to put that together with Harun and Marut. Because weren't they angels as well?
We'll talk about that some other time.
Oh.
Any other questions? So all angels, and they fit in this rule, only do good, only obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and anything you've read or heard and so forth doesn't contradict that. Okay? Because if it does, it's not what we believe. Okay, any other questions? No? They wanted me to play a video, so the computer's gone off. Bismillah. Fahim, could you come forward as well, please? So first of all, we're going to make a few people famous. Well, actually, Fahim, you can go first. You can stand here, you don't have to stand for the ladies, you can stand here and speak. So, we got last week I mentioned our courses, and Brother Fahim was